When Juliet said to Romeo, "What's in a name?" A rose by any other name would smell as sweet. That's the source for the title of this episode, By Any Other Name. Thank you, Bill Shakespeare. As in a number of other Star Trek stories, the human side of emotions play an important part in this tale. We'll discover that what is sometimes regarded as a weakness, namely our ability to experience strong feelings, can indeed be one of our greatest strengths. This is a lesson Mr. Spock learns again and again, and one that Kirk and McCoy take a great delight in teaching. Now, let's meet the Kelvins, visitors from the Andromeda Galaxy. They're looking for a new neighborhood to move into, and they're about to find out what it's like to be all too human. When writer Jerome Bixby came up with the story for this episode, he took the story and the script as far as he could for a first-time Star Trek writer. Then, as on so many other occasions, D.C. Fontana was called in to do a rewrite, once again tweaking it to bring Star Trek's main characters to the forefront, her favorite edition. Scotty's drinking contest. It's during this debacle that we get to peek inside Scotty's liquor cabinet and sample the best of his old Scotch whiskey, the Saurian brandy, and a liquor from Ganymede, which he identifies only as green. There's one basic plot problem for By Any Other Name. The writers had to figure out how six aliens could take over a starship that had a crew of nearly 400. How was it solved? It was while playing with a souvenir piece of Mexican black onyx that Roddenberry's imagination once again was ignited. Suppose the aliens had a weapon which would reduce that person to their essential being or essence. This was the genesis of the tetrahedron blocks. If the white block is damaged, the person is killed. Fortunately, an intact block could be restored to a living entity. Once again, Gene solved what could have been an unsolvable problem.